My name is Potfa Pilingana, the principal of the College of Biomedical Sciences under the Salvation Army and Ministry of Health. So the school essentially started far back in 1945. Currently, we have 252 students. The pass rate for this school has been particularly extremely good. We have maintained 100% for the past 3 years. A biomedical technologist is a health worker who works in partnership with all other health workers, but particularly to do with the aid in diagnosis of disease conditions, also monitoring of treatment, and to a larger extent also in research. We have students that are attached to the clinical lab that are doing laboratory tests for the hospital, and through that the community accesses the service.
My name is Nacho Kamandan, a second year student at Chikankata College of Biomedical Sciences, and I'm the secretary general of the school. In the future, I hope to upgrade in microbiology, or in short, to be a microbiologist with maybe a master's or a PhD. But because of the Salvation Army, I have come to know different things that have made me to make some dreams, to have some dreams of the future.
The Salvation Army plays a very, very major role in the training of these professionals. Zambia is still in short supply of health workers. So the role of the Salvation Army to facilitate the training of health workers helps immensely in alleviating the human resource shortage that is experienced countrywide.
This is the day the Lord has made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. Well, if we haven't had the opportunity to meet, my name is Peter Van Dynen. I'm one of the pastors here at Guelph Citadel. Well, we have been invited to worship. And even though we are still not gathered in person for worship, we can still take on a posture of prayer as we respond to God's invitation this morning. So would you join me in prayer? You are our Lord and our God. You created us. We are your people. You call us beloved. So let us give praise unto your name this morning. Let us remember your unfailing love, love that surpasses, love that does not cease, love that is faithful through all generations. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, the Godhead, three in one, worthy of all praise. Amen.
Darkness, child. Jesus chooses the 12 apostles. Now during those days he went up to the mountain to pray, and he spent the night in prayer to God. And when day came, he called his disciples and chose 12 of them, whom he also named apostles: Simon, whom he named Peter, and his brother Andrew, and James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and Matthew, and Thomas, and James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon, who was called the Zealot, and Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. Jesus teaches and heals. He came down with them and stood on a level place with a great crowd of his disciples and a great multitude of people from all Judea, Jerusalem, and the coast of Tyre and Sidon. They had come to hear him and to be healed of their diseases. And those who were troubled with unclean spirits were cured. And all in the crowd were trying to touch him, for power came out from him and healed all of them.
Presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call.
Today we draw to a close our three-part series about the great mystery that you and I are the beloved sons and daughters of God. When Jesus was baptized, the voice of God spoke to him and said, "You are my beloved. On you my favor rests." And this verse is important for us to hear because Jesus came to let us know that we are as beloved as he is. We are valued and accepted as we are in the stage of life we are in before we do anything, before we have anything, no matter what others say of us. We are enough. In this moment, we are the beloved. And the great challenge in this is to listen to the voice that calls us and reminds us who we truly are, that calls us the beloved, to hear and believe we are enough. And in this sermon, I would invite you to be good listeners, to listen to the voice that calls you the beloved. Now, if I can play around with some words for a moment, you might be interested to know that the word listen in Latin is the word audri. And if you listen with great attention, it is obedri in Latin. That's where the word obedience comes from. The obedient person is someone who listens to the voice that calls them the beloved. And if you're hard of hearing, the Latin word is surdus. And if you are deaf, the Latin word is absurdus. And that's where we get the word absurd from. If you can't hear what is really going on around you, the world is just absurd. Now the question is, can we move from a life of absurdity to a life of obedience? That is from a life in which you can't hear the voice of God, and you get all distracted, and you lose touch with who you really are, and you start thinking, I am what I do, I am what other people say about me, I am what I have. All these false voices that make your life absurd. Or can you gradually start listening to that gentle, soft, whispering voice that says, you are my beloved son or daughter? Our prayer through this series is that you will believe this is how God feels about you, and that you will live from that conviction, and your life will be different, a life of freedom and peace that you long for, that you were made for. Now today I want to talk about what it looks like to be a disciple of the Beloved, to be a disciple of Jesus. The word disciple and the word discipline are the same word. Once you have made the choice to say, yes, I want to follow Jesus, the question is, what disciplines will help me remain faithful to that choice? If we want to be disciples of Jesus, I'm sorry to say, the reality is that it's just too hard for us to leave it to chance, that we'll stumble across into anything and everything that we need. The truth is, we need to live a disciplined life. By discipline, I don't mean control. If I know the discipline of psychology or economics, I have a certain control over the body of knowledge. If I discipline my children, I want to have some control over them, and sometimes that's just a prayer in the wind. But in the spiritual life, the word discipline means the effort to create some space in which God can act. Discipline means to prevent everything in your life from being filled up. And the word, in the world that we live in, it wants to fill up every space you have. It wants you to be occupied. And if you're not already occupied with something, you're likely preoccupied with something else. And that's just being occupied before you're even there. If every minute of your day is jam-packed and there is no space for rest, peace, quiet, then I would be so bold to say something is off kilter and you are in danger of being off the path of the abundant life that God wants for you. The philosopher Spinoza said that humans suffer from horror vacui, a fear of emptiness in our lives. We call it FOMO, the fear of missing out. So we fill it up with everything. We always have to have something or do something or be somewhere or be with someone, and we always have to be doing something. Discipline means that somewhere in your life, you're not occupied and certainly not preoccupied. In the spiritual life, discipline means to create that space in which something can happen that you hadn't planned or counted on. I think three disciplines are important for us to remain faithful to, so we not only become disciples, but also remain disciplined. And these disciplines are contained in one passage from Scripture, which I'm sure you're familiar with, but one that you may be surprised to find out. It speaks about discipline. And this is in Luke. Now it happened in those days that Jesus went on to the mountain to pray, and he spent the whole night in prayer to God. When day came, he summoned his disciples and picked out 12 of them and called them apostles. Simon, whom he called Peter, and his brother Andrew, James, John, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, and Thomas, James, son of Alphaeus, Simon, called the Zealot, Judas, son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became the traitor. He then came down with them and stopped at a piece of level ground where there was a large gathering of his disciples. There was a great crowd of people from all parts of Judea and Jerusalem and the coastal region of Tyre and Sidon who had come to hear him and be cured of their diseases. And people tormented by unclean spirits were also cured. Everyone in the crowd was trying to touch him because power came out of him that cured him. And that's from the book of Luke. Now this is a beautiful story that moves from night to morning to afternoon, the Jewish marking of the time in a day. Jesus spent the night in communion with God in the morning. He gathered his disciples around him, called out the 12 apostles, and formed community with them. In the afternoon, with his apostles, he went out and preached the word and healed the sick and cared for the poor. So notice the order from communion to community to ministry. The night is for communion, the morning for community, and the afternoon for ministry. So often in ministry, I have wanted to do it by myself. If it didn't work, I went to others and said, please, you know, searching for a community to help me. And if that didn't work, maybe then I'd start to pray. But that order, Jesus teaches, is the reverse. It's supposed to begin with God and communion. Then it creates a fellowship and a community of people with whom the mission is being lived. And finally, this community goes out together to heal and to proclaim the good news. I believe we look at communion and community and ministry as three disciplines by which we create space for God. If we create space in which God can act and speak something, surprising something, the deepest parts of us long for what will happen. And I believe you and I are called to these disciplines if we want to be disciples. So the first discipline is communion. Communion is being with God and God alone. Is there any space for that in your life? Why is this so important that you are with God and God alone on the mountaintop? It's important because it's the place in which you can listen to the voice of the one who calls you the beloved. To pray is to listen to the one who calls you my beloved daughter, my beloved son, my beloved child. To pray is to let that voice speak to the center of your being. And to let that voice resound in your whole being. Only from this place can you move into the world without it bashing you to bits. Who am I? I'm the beloved. That's the voice Jesus heard when he came out of the Jordan River. You are my beloved, on you my favor rests. And Jesus says to you and to me that we are loved as he is loved. That same voice is there for you. When you are not claiming that voice, you cannot walk freely in this world. You will be entangled with the lies of you are what you can achieve, you are what others say about you, or you are what you have. Jesus listened to the true voice all the time, and he was able to walk right through life. People were applauding him and laughing at him, praising him and rejecting him, calling Hosanna and calling crucify. But in the midst of all of that, Jesus knew one thing. I am the beloved. I am God's favorite. He clung to that voice. There are many other voices speaking loudly. Prove that you are the beloved. Prove you're worth something. Prove you have anything to contribute. Do something relevant. Be sure you make a name for yourself. Be smart. Be intelligent. At least you're going to have some power. Then people will love you. Then people will say you were wonderful and great. Say the right thing. Do the right thing and never mess up. These voices are so strong in this world. These were the voices Jesus heard right at the beginning of his ministry. Prove that you are the beloved and do something. Change these stones into bread. Be sure to be famous. Jump from the temple and you'll be known. Grab some power so you have real influence. Don't you want some influence? Isn't that why you came? But Jesus responded, "No, I don't have to prove anything. I am already worthy. Valued, accepted, I'm already enough." If you keep that in mind, you can deal with an enormous amount of success as well as an enormous amount of failure without losing your identity, because your identity is that you are the beloved. Long before your father and mother, your brothers, your sisters, your teachers, your church, or any people affected you in a loving or wounding way, long before you were rejected by some person or praised by somebody else, the voice has been always there. I have loved you with an everlasting love. And that voice you go to into this world and touch people and heal them and speak with them and make them aware that they are beloved as well, chosen and blessed. When you discover your belovedness by God, you see the belovedness of other people and call that forth in them. It's an incredible mystery of God's love, that the more you know you are deeply loved, the more you will be able to deeply love your brothers and sisters in our human family. Now, it's not easy. Jesus spent the night in prayer. And that's a picture of the fact that prayer is not something you always feel. It's not a voice you always hear with your ears. It's not always an insight that suddenly comes to your mind. So you have to pray, you have to listen to the voice who calls you the beloved, because otherwise you will run around begging for affirmation, for praise, for success, and then you're not free. Have you ever sat for a half an hour doing nothing? It's hard, isn't it? Not listening to the radio, not watching TV, not reading the paper, not scrolling on your phone, not thinking about your to-do list. It's hard to sit down in a chair and do nothing. Henry Nouwen says, your inner life is like a banana tree filled with monkeys. jumping up and down. I should do this, I should do that. I have to write a letter, I have to go here, I forgot about that. I'm still angry at this person, I should have done that. I didn't do that, and before you know it, your mind is gone and you get busy trying to deal with all the monkeys. It's not easy to sit and trust that in communion, God will speak to you. And in that word from God, you will find the inner place from which to live your life. Communion is where spiritual ministry begins. It's the foundation. If we don't have that as individuals, we are off kilter as a church family and in ministry. As communion is where Jesus listened to God, and that's where we listen to God. It might be helpful to think of life as a big wagon wheel with many spokes, and the middle is the hub. And often in ministry, it looks like we're running around the rim trying to reach everybody. But God says, start in the hub, live in the hub. Then you will be connected with all the spokes, and you won't have to run so fast. So now that we've looked at communion, let's look at community. It's precisely in the hub, in that communion with God, that we discover the call to community. It's remarkable that communion always calls us to community. In communion, you realize you're a part of a human family and that you want to lift something together. That is part of the reason this pandemic is so difficult. Something that always has been radically reconfigured and or simply discontinued. And that is community in all its forms. And by community, I don't mean formal communities. I mean families and friends and churches and 12-step programs and prayer groups and hockey groups and all these things that we do. And community, it's not an organization. Community is a way of living together. You gather around your people with whom you want to proclaim the truth that we are the beloved sons and daughters of God. And community isn't easy. Somebody once said, community is the place where the person you least want to live with always lives. In Jesus's community of 12 apostles, the last name was that of someone who is going to betray him. That person is always in your community somewhere. In the eye of others, you might be that person. I lived in a community when I was in training college, a very tight community, one of about 50 people where men and women and children lived together, ate together, worked together, worshiped together. We shared all aspects of day-to-day living together. And it wasn't always easy. There were people who got under your skin from time to time. And yet we shared an experience that drew us close together as individuals who all had this understanding that we were the beloved sons and daughters of God who had been called into a particular type of ministry as Salvation Army officers. Guelph Citadel has been a community for over 137 years. How long have you traveled with this community? I'm sure there are people that have gotten under your skin, that aren't your favorite people, that you have wounded or have wounded you. And the fact is, someone might be thinking that of you as well. Community isn't easy, yet God calls us to community because there is something in community. If we fight for it and don't allow the woundedness to destroy us, is the something that helps heal the world. Which points to the importance that communion comes before community. If we don't know we are the beloved sons and daughters of God, we're going to expect someone in the community to make us feel that way, and they can't. We'll expect someone to give us that perfect unconditional love. But community is not loneliness grabbing onto loneliness. I'm so lonely and you're so lonely, so let's get together. It's communion grabbing onto communion. I am the beloved, you are the beloved, and together we build something together and we build community. Sometimes you're close and that's wonderful. And sometimes you don't feel much love and that's hard. But we can be faithful. We can build a community together and create space for God and for the children of God. Community is not some kind of romantic ideal, but you can only live in community if in a deep way your heart is rooted in God. And then you can live with the people who are hard on you, and they become the people who can purify your heart and deepen your love. So communion, community, and now ministry. And if you dare to listen to the voice of love and community, then you will discover very quickly that you are sent out to minister. All the disciples of Jesus are called to ministry. Ministry is not first off something that you do, although it calls you to do many things. Ministry is something that you have to trust. If you know you are the beloved, and if you have relationships with others with whom you form community, ministry is the organic and natural outpouring of that reality. Jesus cured people not by doing all sorts of complicated things. A power went out from him and everyone was cured. He didn't say, "Let me talk to you for 10 minutes and walk you through these steps and maybe I can do something about this." Everyone who touched him changed because a power went out from his pure heart. He wanted one thing, and that was to do the will of God. He was the completely obedient one, the one who was always listening to God. And out of this listening came an intimacy with God that radiated out to everyone Jesus saw and touched. Ministry means you have to trust that. You have to trust that if you are the son and daughter of God, power will go out from you and that people will be healed. Go out and heal the sick. Walk on the snake, call the dead to life. This is not small talk. And Jesus said, "Whatever I do, you can do too, and even greater things." Jesus said precisely, "You are sent into the world just as I was sent into the world, to heal and to cure." Trust in that power. Trust that if you are living as the beloved, you will heal people whether or not you notice it. But you have to be faithful to that call. And it's also important for us to know that often the voice from the beloved comes from those we minister to. One of the ministries Peter and I have been involved in over the years is to visit nursing homes and spending time with residents. And when we spend time there, we meet some people who are bedridden, some who can't walk and some who can't talk. And every couple of months, we would visit and conduct worship services. And yet, when we go and worship together, and there are people who have been wheeled into the chapel, some who can't talk and some who have to be fed and some who need to be wheeled from one place to another. Yet when we sing together, when we pray together and we visit together, they are the people who often gave us life. They are often the ones through who God has chosen to speak his word to love, a word of love to us. Remember what Jesus says in the Beatitudes, "Blessed are the poor, blessed out of the morning." Jesus doesn't say, "Blessed are those that care for the poor." He doesn't say, "Blessed are those that console the mourning." The blessing is located in the poor and those who mourn. And those people that we want to help and minister to, we will find that they carry the blessing in their hearts already for us. And you know who the poor are. You know who the weak are. Even if they're wealthy, they may still be poor. Our Western world is filled with people who look and act and talk as if they have it all together, and yet are the most broken and need of healing more than most. And so you and I are called not just to communion and community, but also to go out and to minister and to trust that those we minister to will lead us closer and closer and closer still to the heart of love, to the heart of God. That is the great joy that I hope you will trust. Because once you encounter a deep communion with the poor and the broken, you will discover your own poverty and your own weakness and your own brokenness and not be afraid of it. And so in a way, we become a fellowship of the weak, where the power of God's grace can manifest itself. Make some space for God's voice, some space by praying, some space for forming community, and some space for going out to minister to those people in your own family or your friends or your workplace or your neighborhood. They don't just need you because they're needy. They also need to give you their blessing because you're as needy as well. And trust that God really wants you to claim the truth that you are the beloved sons and daughters of God today. Let's pray. God, help us today to welcome Jesus in our life, the Jesus we meet in our own family, among our friends, in our neighborhoods, and to truly believe that as we reach out, we will discover that Jesus is still among us, still smiles at us, still gives us his blessing. Bless us today, each one of us in this congregation, each one of us who listens to the word of God, that something really new will happen among us that comes from your life given for us. This is what we're praying. In Jesus' name, amen.
days of darkness there may be for me, rough and steep to my pathway may be, but the joy or the sorrow that comes with tomorrow will just be the fittest for me. Steps I will follow, come joy, I'll come sorrow, dear Savior, I will follow thee. Though by darkness my future is veiled, here's my hope, for thine love steps I will follow, come joy or come sorrow, dear Savior, I will follow thee.
Well, friends, thank you for joining us in worship today. Before you go, I do want to share a few announcements with you. The first one is just a reminder that the Women's Ministry Virtual Spring Social is taking place this afternoon at 3:30. Now, this is a Zoom event, and the link has been emailed out to everyone in our church email list as well. We've posted the link on our Facebook group. So if you're available this afternoon at 3:30, brew yourself a nice pot of tea or coffee. And don't forget, ladies, wear something green. The second announcement is a reminder to join us for the Together in Vision conversation with our territorial leaders that is taking place on Wednesday, March 24th at 7 p.m. That's this coming Wednesday. Our international leader, General Brian Peddle, will be joining us from London, England, and various music groups from across the Canada and Bermuda territory will be featured each month. This is an ongoing Zoom event. Like I said, it takes place each month for the next 4 or 5 months. So you're gonna need to visit salvationist.ca/togetherinvision for more information and to register for your Zoom link. Finally, I want you to be aware of some dates to save that are related to our online Holy Week services. First, next Sunday is Palm Sunday. And we're gonna have a special prayer emphasis during that service as we recognize the International Day of Prayer for Children and Youth. Then on Thursday, April the 1st at 6:30 in the evening, we want you to carve out about an hour of time for a special Messiah in the Passover service, which will be a joint service with our friends at Priory Park Baptist Church. This is going to be an interactive service where you can participate from home. So we've provided you instructions and a shopping list so that you can pick up the various ingredients and get prepared for the service beforehand. And you can download that instruction sheet at guelphsa.ca/Easter. Now on Good Friday, our Tenebrae service will take place at 6:30 in the evening, and we'll be journeying together through the Stations of the Cross as we hear scripture, reflect on it, and have an opportunity to sing together. And finally, we invite you to join us online on Easter Sunday morning as we celebrate the resurrection of our Lord. All of these services will be online, and you'll be able to access them on our website, on our Facebook page, and our Facebook group. As well, links will be provided in the weekly email newsletter that will be coming out the Friday right before Holy Week. Looking forward to the many opportunities that we'll have to worship as a community, even though we may be physically apart. So stay tuned to our social media, a weekly email update to keep connected on what's going on at Guelph Citadel. Now, would you hear these good things that God has to say about you? Do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have summoned you by name. You are mine. You are precious and honored in my sight, and I love you. So go. Claim your identity as the beloved children of God. God has called you by name. We go into the world to answer God's call. Hallelujah.